Hello all guys, gals, and non-binary pals. Welcome to the newest episode of the Noobs and Knockouts podcast, brought to you on YouTube, on Spotify, on Google and Apple Podcasts. I'm Austin. I'm a knockout, watch a lot of wrestling.
I'm David. I'm a noob, haven't watched nearly as much wrestling, and what a day to be talking about a show where half the focus is the megalomaniacal wrestling booker boss. Because yes. Oh boy.
Yeah, so we don't usually talk about news and current event wrestling stuff on this podcast. We usually stick to retrospective stuff.
We stay in our goddamn lane here at the Noobs and Knockouts podcast.
We do, but like 3 hours ago, from time of when we're recording this, the new biggest news story in decades dropped. So I guess we should probably mention it, at least in passing. That Vince McMahon is retired now.
Yeah, Vince McMahon at 77 years young has stepped down as head of everything at WWE. Now, he still has his majority share, far as I can tell.
Yes.
However,
that's it. He has no other power CEO. In day-to-day. He has he's no, no other longer power head in day-to-day operations. No.
Yeah, no. He's no... So he's... I don't know, probably still fucking sitting in on board meetings or whatever.
Yeah,
but like, other than that, he ain't there.
This is the least amount of power Vince has had in 40 years.
Yeah.
Since he bought the company from his dad.
And Triple H has officially taken over for John Laurinaitis.
Yep. Earlier today, it was announced that Triple H is back as executive vice president. Of talent relations.
Much for him and Stephanie stepping the fuck away.
Yeah, well, Stephanie McMahon is now co-CEO with Nick Khan, who has been making waves, is kind of taking over more of the business dealings of the WWE in the last couple of years. He's credited for being the person behind the, you know, let's fire dozens and dozens and dozens of people.
The dueling cons. Mm-hmm. Or the con that giveth and the con that taketh away.
Mm-hmm. So I guess if I want to be fair and balanced, TMC and R.
Totally R bit that we're that we're not.
Yeah, we invented that one, of course. Mm-hmm. But you know, a lot of people's Vince McMahon was very successful with WWE. His company is a gateway for a lot of people into pro wrestling, me included.
Yep.
And as an on-screen character, one of the greatest heels of all time and top two evil general managers, to get more, you know, specific about it. I feel Dario Cueto, who's that also ties what else we're doing today.
Yeah. Hey,
is the only real competition in that regard. So that's that. But also, fuck Vince McMahon. I'm very happy he's gone, because I don't really, if it was just about, man, I haven't liked WWE TV in a couple of years, I wouldn't have this kind of take on it. You know, TV, it's just a television show. The thing is that Vince McMahon has a long history of allegations that paint him as a total shithead. I don't have time to cover them all, so I will just run through the big highlights.
Yep.
He is pretty famously alleged to have helped cover up the murder of Jimmy Snuka's girlfriend, which was done by Jimmy Snuka back in the early 80s. In 1992, the very first WWF female referee, Rita Chatterton, accused Vince of raping her in a limousine on the Geraldo Rivera show. And that has recently resurfaced as that story has finally been really corroborated after 30 years in light of this Wall Street Journal story. And we'll get to that in a second. Vince is absolutely responsible for the death of Owen Hart live on pay-per-view, because it was his call to use shoddy equipment that led to and stunts that led to his fall. And Also, as recently learned and through the Wall Street Journal, Vince McMahon has paid in the last decade has paid $12 million to various mistresses he had and affairs he had he has had while being CEO of the company as hush money.
Yep, and that is the tip of the iceberg. Mm-hmm. Not to mention every little thing you can go down for all the shady business practices that he's engaged mm-hmm. in, all the shit with the steroid trial that he, you know, worked his bullshit to get off scot-free on, you know, his role in the Montreal screw job, the endless accounts there are of wrestlers under his parlay, like, on his watch, getting very sick, getting horribly, irreparably injured, you know, death as a result of all of these things, and his very famously cavalier attitude toward it, clearly racist and sexist views that he holds on the day-to-day and or is willing to endorse or platform on his wrestling TV show. You know, this is a man who, even if it was for heel heat, has just straight up said the N-word on WWE TV. And, yeah. You know, somehow don't get the feeling that was meant to be a deep dive examination of all of our internalized racism or like all the racism in the wrestling industry. Mm-hmm. So, you know, on so many levels, fuck Vince McMahon. I am so happy that he is goddamn gone.
Yep. And which is not to say that, of course, WWE is still a corporation. So, you know, I'm sure it can only get so much better from here, but it's always good when the sex pests are gone.
Yes. So,
bye, John Laurinaitis. Bye, Vince. I'm not really going to miss you.
I am so happy bye, Bozo. Like, I'm sorry. I just got nothing other than like, yep, good. Next.
Yeah. So that is that. And so now let's get back to our regularly scheduled programming of the evening.
The fun evil wrestling boss guy who's like okay to like because he's completely fictional.
Yes, it is finally time to return to Lucha Underground. You know, we've had to take a couple weeks off from recording, plus our schedule moved around because, you know, we had to do the AEW episode that week to do that show. So it's been a while since we've been doing Lucha.
We had done Temple,
so it is good to be back. Kind of as a reminder of what happened last time is the biggest thing that took up an entire episode was Prince Puma defeating Johnny Mundo in an all night long match.
Yeah, literally an entire episode. That was a big old big boy fight that took some big boy time to get through it. And of course it was a nail biter, Jesus, right up until the goddamn end. Oh boy. Oh man, they were tied up until the very last second. Holy shit.
Who could have predicted that?
Oh man.
Please don't look at any other Iron Man matches.
No. What is an Iron Man match? The all night long match is a completely original invention of Dario Cueto that nobody's ever thought of before. He's a creative genius and should be respected as such.
You're correct. So the other big thing is that Drago returned to the temple and he assaulted Dario Cueto in the bathroom to get him.
Because of course he did.
Yeah. A lot of bathroom fighting happened.
Drago's a natural. The bathroom is Drago's natural habitat, okay? Like, he just loves, I guess, the smell of human feces.
Yeah, so he used that as a way to get inserted into the number one contenders match for Prince Puma's title at Ultima Lucha, and he won. He is officially back in the temple. He has his job back. Great, except for the fact that Katrina came into Dario's office and choked him until he gave Mil Muertes a match against Drago for the number one contendership at Ultima Lucha.
Yeah, which Dario was totally not into being choked. What are you talking about?
Yeah, so to be clear, Drago's job is no longer on the line. But, not feeling great about Prince Puma versus Drago for Ultima Lucha.
Yeah, I don't know how that's gonna turn out, and we got a whole ass Mil Muertes to deal with. I get the feeling that between the enraged Dragon Man, the big ol' scary zombie man, and the heretofore unseen Eldritch Abomination that Dario's keeping in the basement is also blood related to, somebody's head's gonna roll at some point. Don't know who, but there is death to be had over the, you know, earth-shattering prize of a underground Fight Club championship belt.
It is all about that Aztec warfare. Wait, that's a different thing in this
wrestling show. Wrestling makes sense and has reasonable proportional stakes.
Of course. Then of course, Chavo Guerrero is now kind of the leader of the crew, and he has kidnapped poor Black Lotus and thrown her in a cell next to Matanza Cueto.
Yeah, not even in the same cell, just in an adjacent cell that he happens to have.
That the temple has more than one cell.
Yeah. And but he's just, I don't understand why Dario just won't feed her to him. Like, I feel like that'd be the expedient way to do it. Don't know why. Don't know if that's gonna get explained, aside from the fact that, you know, we just gotta settle everything in the ring, but she is trapped and not dead. In that order.
Yeah. But Chavo used his newfound favor with the boss to beat the shit out of Blue Demon again.
Yeah, again, because fuck, you know, you're a living legend in you know, Mexico in Lucha Libre. Fuck you. You're just gonna
get shit on.
You're just gonna job to all of our villains on our goddamn show. What the hell?
We're gonna use you to garner sympathy and nothing else.
Why are you using Blue Demon this way? I feel like this man has better things to do than just go on Lucha Underground and lose all the goddamn time.
And then, of course, the Disciples of Death arrived and beat up some of our fan favorite jobbers.
They control electricity now. Cool. And yeah, fucking Justice for Pimpinella and Masquerita and the goddamn tiger dude whose name I can't remember.
Bengala.
Oh yeah, he's a Bengal tiger. Yeah. Yeah. Bengala, who I immediately loved because he does cool flippy shit, and I love me some cool flippy shit. And Masquerita Sagrada and goddamn Pimpinella are finally back, and they just got immediately goddamn trashed by the Servants of Death, because fucking of course they did. We can't have nice things in the Underground Fight Club.
Of course, which, by the way, I do have the names of the Disciples of Death now.
They have names?
They do.
They aren't just Thing 1, Thing 2, Thing 3?
No! It's Barrio Negro, El Sinestro de la Muerte, and Trece. I couldn't tell you which is which, but that are their names.
De la Muerte and Trece?
Yeah. T-R-E-C-E.
What's it? 13. Wait. So we have Black Neighborhood or Dark Neighborhood, El Sinestro de la Muerte, I don't know, something sinister about death, and 13. What the fuck? Man. Oh, man. The Mexicools are a lot different than I remember them.
I cannot wait to get back to them next week.
Oh, Christ.
Speaking of, I got a thing about Chavo next week to talk about that I'm excited to learn now.
See, I actually just learned something. I didn't realize that Chavo was like a junior.
Yes,
as you are aware, I'm finally like kind of like watching through Glow. And like one of the season one episodes was dedicated to the memory of Chavo Guerrero Sr., who had just died, and I was like, oh shit! I didn't realize there was an elder.
Yes, Chavo Guerrero Sr. Yeah, he worked on the original Glow as a trainer.
Oh, shit.
If I'm remembering that right. I assume that's why they did that.
I mean, whoever is fucking making Glow clearly has connections to the industry, considering, like, all the goddamn people they get to just, like, show up on that show. So it makes sense either way. But, yeah, that's goddamn cool.
Yeah. Yes, so I don't...
And fucking Christian Cage about to come out here and be like, Chavo, your dead dad would be disappointed in you, and I'm going to fuck your mom.
Please come out and say that, Mr. Cage.
Maybe we can get the other Cage to cut that promo instead. He is around a bit more often in the Underground Fight Club.
Yeah, let's see. I don't believe there is anything else to talk about, because story-wise, there wasn't as much advancement as we usually might get for one of our episodes, because, you know, we spent a whole episode on one match. So, you know, it's not... not as much story advancement, not as much time for it. But I do know that I'll go ahead and read the names of the episodes we're going to watch today and not spoil anything to do minimal spoiling on my part. So the first episode is season 1, episode 33, Death versus the Drago.
Wonder what's going to happen there.
Of course. And... Then season 1, episode 34, Gold and Guerreros.
That just makes sense there. That's just a title that makes sense.
Yeah.
If there's anything the Guerreros love, it's some motherfucking gold.
Mm-hmm. So according, the episode 33, description, it says Cueto sets a rematch between Superfly and Sexy Star.
Oh, shit.
So we're going to come back to that. Wait, he's still allowed to
call himself Superfly? Shouldn't he be calling himself something else now?
No, you can keep the name, you just can't keep the mask.
Wait, what? I thought the whole thing is that, like, the persona dies with the mask, and so you have to, like, fucking reinvent yourself or something.
Nah, it's a little more loosey-goosey than that. It's kind of whatever.
Well, that kind of takes away some of the fun of the whole mask-losing thing. What the hell?
Then we get a Aerostar, the Mac, Marty the Moth Martinez, Cage, and Pentagon Jr. compete in a 5-way Aztec medallion match.
Oh, so
then we continue to hand out the Aztec medallions. So far it's just been Jack Evans and Phoenix with each getting a medallion, but so it's not tonight we're gonna give medallion number 3.
I'm fucking rooting for Moth Boy to inevitably get one of these medallions.
Yes! Marty the Moth.
He still weirds me out a little bit, but I feel like it's just like inevitable that he's gonna get one of these goddamn medallions, so I figure I might as well hop on the train while I still can, you know? Chug it, baby.
Gotta get on the hype train early.
Yeah, you know, you usually get perks for being an early adapter. So I'm just trying to, like, you know, get my due or whatever. I don't know.
Yeah. And then of course Drago and Mil Muertes fight for a spot in Ultima Lucha.
Wow, shocker.
As we mentioned earlier in the time. So I will not do the episode 34 intro thing.
Ooh.
Because it's obvious, as I don't think it's meant to be. You know, we haven't seen episode 33 yet.
Suspense-a-reno. I respect it.
Yeah. So, if you would like to watch along with us, well, your options are slim. So, you can, of course, it is available on, I know it's available on iTunes. I'm sure it's Amazon Prime. You can also buy the seasons. I haven't looked. But let's be real here. We're not doing that. If you go on the Internet Archive to pirate all of Lucha Underground, and that
yo ho, pirate's life for us.
Yes,
as always, the true rename of our show coming down the pike, the Pirates and Pirates Podcast, as we do.
If it just feels right to pirate a show about an illegal underground fight club.
Yeah, we're being thematic here, okay? We can't get prosecuted if there's thematic cohesion. That's the law.
If you pirate something that's already illegal, that's a double negative. I think that cancels out.
I think that's legitimate. That sounds perfectly legit to me.
Yeah, anyway, that'll be that. We are again, we will see you guys in the back half to talk about more Lucha Underground Season 1.
Yep.
And we are back. We have just finished Season 1, Episode 33 and 34 of Lucha Underground.
Hell yeah, brother. Things just keep on fucking ramping up. They're preparing for Ultima Lucha. They got their retro-looking ass match cards, visuals, whatever, like up on screen to announce some of the shows we got coming up, or the matches we got coming up for Ultima Lucha. Shit's getting wild, baby.
Yep. Unfortunately, for the stage is getting set for Ultima Lucha, and unfortunately, not looking as good as for Drago now that the stage is being constructed. As what you probably guessed was going to happen is what happened.
Yeah, you know, am I shocked? No. Am I sad? Yes. I like my Dragon Boy. I don't like Zombie Man. You know, my preferences here should be kind of obvious.
Mm-hmm.
Fuck that zombie guy. Anyway.
Yeah, but let's go ahead and start from the top. Right at the top, we get the announcement that Alberto El Patron versus Johnny Mundo is announced for Ultima Lucha.
The Alberto's going to get that revenge for Johnny throwing him through a window. I'm sure.
Yeah, I cannot wait to talk about that when we get there.
That's going to be interesting. I'm sure I'm going to be annoyed by all the dipshits in the audience being like, oh, Alberto El Patron is a gift to wrestling. Fuck this Johnny Mundo guy because... Yeah. You know, shockingly, the opposite is true. Go fuck yourselves.
Yeah, but that is the second official match set for Ultima Lucha, though a lot of the... As someone who already knows what happens at Ultima Lucha 1, a lot of the pieces are being set, and you can tell where stuff is going for a lot of the pieces for Lucha Underground, for Ultima Lucha.
Yeah, I mean, it's the cool thing about what we've got with Lucha Underground so far is like we've had so like we kind of touched on this in our last episode. There are a lot of moving parts to Lucha Underground. Like there is for any wrestling show, but there's something about Ultima Lucha that makes it feel as though it's something about Lucha Underground that like makes everything feel like I don't know. It's just more intimate almost like. Mm-hmm. Everything kind of like connects in a slightly more visceral way. So we're getting all these like matchups kind of brewing, and it kind of feels like this cool hodgepodge of like just all these little vignettes we've seen scattered about. Nothing huge. There aren't a whole lot of like super long standing rivalries coming into Ultima Lucha. Like there are some that have been going on for a hot minute, but like a lot of them are a bit more of a hodgepodge. It's this cool thing of it's this cool phenomenon of oh hey we're gonna throw these two dudes together and like you know you saw little like clips of them beefing so let's make it really official. I don't know, there's something about that structuring to the plot that I really like.
Mm-hmm. First match of the show is Sexy Star versus Superfly. Before Superfly comes down to the ring, we get a quick cut. To another Vampiro sit down interview. I am gonna miss these.
Wait, you're gonna miss them? Are they going away?
Yeah, they don't really exist after this season, really.
I'm gonna miss them too. I mean, they're bullshit, but they're great.
I don't wanna talk about everything that kind of changed with Lucha Underground until we get to the next seasons. But yeah, these don't become as regular a feature after this season.
Sad. I immediately, when I saw that Vamp was interviewing Superfly, I was like, of fucking course, because Vamp has to be the ultimate shitster, and he interviewed Sexy Star, so now, of course, he's got to get the other side of the story.
Yeah, and, though he does come at it from, like, Superfly, what was that about, my man?
Yeah, and Superfly's just kind of, like, fucking incel posting up in here. He's like, no. Sexy Star stole something from me, so I need to steal something from her. Like, my man, she didn't want to do this. You begged her to take your mask off, like, do the honorable thing. She tried to say no. She didn't want to. You, What? Well, what is happening? Well, he's like, she could have walked away. She could have left the tent. So could you have, asshole. Why is it her job to lay the fuck down for you?
Yeah, he spent a few weeks sitting on it and then decided that actually Sexy Star is a piece of shit.
Yeah.
Which is completely illogical. And Vampiro does call him out on it.
Yeah. I will give Vamp this. A broken Vampiro is right twice a day still. And Vamp is squarely on the side of, dude, what the fuck? Chill out.
Yeah. Vampiro is very straightforward that Sexy Star did not really have any agency in how all this went down. And Superfly's like, still her fault though.
Yeah, Superfly says, fuck your facts and logic. My feels say it's her fault.
Yeah.
Even though that's like so, oh God. Fuck, man, fuck this guy. What an effective way to turn someone heel is just to make them a completely illogical, like, incel. Okay,
yeah,
dude.
Yeah, pretty much. And he suggests that he took it easy on her the first time.
Because she's a woman.
Woman.
Go fuck yourself.
Yeah, fuck him. So that's how that interview went. You know, not as explosive as some of Vampiro's interviews, but it firmly establishes that Superfly sucks.
We are firmly in fuck this guy Superfly territory, which, man, if you had told me like half a season ago that I would have been thinking about Superfly, I would have been like, wait, no, he's such a pure boy with a nice little like vibe. What's wrong with him? Oh, nah, I guess he was just one bad day away from going Joker mode or whatever.
He lost his mask and found the red pill.
Yeah.
So look what happened.
Ah, fucking hell. And he's got dopey ass like face paint around one of his eyes that I can't decipher what the hell it's even supposed to be. He's just got a whole thing going on. He's riding them cringe lord waves, I tell you.
Yeah. So the match is honestly fine. A little one-sided towards Superfly. You got to show how he's all mean and dangerous now, I guess.
Yeah, seriously.
Yeah.
It's weirdly one-sided too, because Sexy Star's gone to like war against some of Lucha Underground's toughest and has come out either victorious or like with a really strong like appearance to her. But in this, like, Superfly kind of bowls her over a little bit and it feels almost like out of place.
Yeah, like she went pretty toe to toe with Mil Muertes back in Aztec Warfare, and this is the woman who it was absolutely implied that she was gonna tap out Pentagon Jr. until Superfly showed up and ruined everything.
Yeah, seriously. Like, so I don't know, like, what we're like, are we trying to? I would say, like, okay, this is an attempt to power up Superfly then, but we're still coming off the fact that Superfly up until like just now has been the jobber of all jobbers.
Yeah, he's kind of a dope.
Yeah, just kind of a fucking dope. And we're just all of a sudden having him conquer Sexy Star in a match that wasn't all that impressive a showing, all things considered. So like,
Superfly is athletic, but he is vastly outshined by a lot of people in Lucha Underground.
Like, you could say in theory that, like, oh, Sexy Star's head isn't in the game. She's like distracted by what the fuck is happening with my former friend. But they don't really play into that. Her physicality doesn't play into that. And like, it kind of goes against her character to be like that anyway. Like she was out of her element a little bit when she fought Superfly originally, and because she clearly didn't want to like unmask him and was like doing this out of pure like desperate necessity. But you know, once somebody has wronged her, Sexy Star is not the type to take any shit. So I mean, you can headcanon it, but that only takes you so far. Come on, guys.
Yeah, it's weird. My notes are: Vampiro tells Superfly to stop being a bitch.
Yeah, stop being a bitch and get on with life, brother. Fucking based. God, I for once I'm agreeing with Vamp on his bullshit. I'm here for this.
Yeah, Stryker tries to make some sort of suggestion that Sexy Star has too many fans and thus might try too hard to impress them at her own physical detriment. I don't really see how that played into what the match was, but he mentioned it, and I was like, that's a weird comment.
Yeah, right? Yeah, Vamp and Stryker, like, spend a whole lot of time, like, having this, like, hashtag deep convo about whether or not Sexy Star is, like, able to overcome the odds X amount of times. Like, the odds are always stacked against her, can't you? And they both seem to, like, have a weird amount of, like, philosophical and, like, sentimental stock in this conversation. It's kind of out of left field, but it's almost kind of hilarious to hear the two of them, like, have a hashtag serious business conversation about, like, how resilient Sexy Star potentially
is. Yeah. I made note that Sexy Star had a couple of her dives where, like, just barely made it and was kind of flailing. I was like, whoa there.
Oh, shit. Something I noticed that you said you missed was toward the end of the match, we get what looks like a, like, Superfly, like, ass-tapping Sexy Star. She's, like, bouncing off the ropes to hit him. Ain't no judging. There's nothing like a friendly ass tap between two enemies in the ring.
Yeah, however, yeah.
I was like, huh, that's unusual. But eventually Superfly gets the dub because of course he does. God damn it.
Yeah. One last note from Strike from during one of Sexy Star's comebacks, she was just like stomping down on Superfly, and I made a note of NPR said she's stomping a mud hole on his ass for being such a dick.
True. I'm here for Mudhole stomping for being a dick.
Yeah, but eventually Superfly hits a sit-out powerbomb and wins, whatever. And then Superfly, after the match, starts putting the boots to her and, like, tries to unmask her. It's a thing he tries to
do
a couple of times during the match. But he also isn't very committed to the idea because she, like, pushes him off and he's like, okay, I guess you can leave.
Yeah, stay mad, asshole.
For a guy who's committed to making Sexy Star feel the pain that he felt, he sure to give up quick at unmasking.
Yeah.
And then I made a note that as they rolled on to commercial, there was a "No One Likes You" chant at Superfly.
True, fucking true, man. Again, I would have chafed at that like half a season ago, but God damn, this guy's such an asshole.
Yeah.
Superfly really came in and was like, fuck all of you. My stellar reputation was slightly sullied. I'm going to, like, hate everyone and everything forever now.
Reputation, you say? Superfly be like, look what you made me do.
Look what you made me. Oh, God. It's going to be some like, Katy Perry, Taylor Swift shit? Was that the feud?
That was, but I don't think that song wasn't about that one. That song wasn't about the Katy Perry, Taylor Swift feud. Bad Blood was.
Oh, yeah. I get all this shit mixed up.
It's fine. I'm not a big fan of either song I just referenced in the last 30 seconds.
Hey-o.
I just saw a reference to make. Anyway. As you do. Anyway, we get a transition video of Drago at dawn somewhere flipping nunchucks.
Yeah, on top of a building. Drago is training by practicing with his nunchuka for some reason. And he's like, you know, probably on top of the temple building, if I had to guess. He does tend to like it up there. It's either like on top of the temple building or like fucking in the bathrooms underground. So, you know, kind of obvious where his preferences lie. And like, set against, admittedly, a pretty cool, like, stark contrast color shot of Dawn outside Dawn in Boyle Heights. Real artistic shit, even if it's like, since when do dragons use nunchucks?
We'll get more into that later.
Yeah, that's a later thing.
So the next match of the show is the five-way match between Aerostar, Pentagon Jr., Marty the Moth Martinez, Cage, and the Mac for one of the Aztec medallions.
Yeah.
And out comes Pentagon, and he rips the microphone away from Melissa Santos.
And he tries to fucking attack Melissa Santos because still dead set on breaking her arm, I guess.
He's still got her arm in his mind.
Melissa Santos is hashtag the one that got away.
So Pentagon, even he explains that he wants to offer his master more than just some medallion.
Yeah, he wants something, you know, gold medallions, whatever. He wants something far more valuable, which is, of course, more arm bones.
He wants revenge. Penta for says, the man. Penta
says, it's a bones day.
He wants to destroy the man that took away his greatest sacrifice to his master.
Which, his greatest sacrifice would have been Sexy Star's arm? That is the most.
I mean, she's by far the strongest wrestler he would have broken an arm of at this point.
This is true. I guess, like, I don't know, lady arms go for a lot in the dark master market. So
I guess,
you know,
so. So he wants.
You learn something new about economics every day, huh?
Yeah. So Pentagon Jr. says, "Fuck this match! I want to fight Vampiro right now."
Yeah, he literally just entered this match as a ploy to, like, get in the ring and just challenge Vamp to a street fight or whatever.
Yeah, so Pentagon, he rolls on over to the announce table, and Vampiro is still like, I shouldn't have gotten off the table last time. I don't really want to do this. I'm trying to be a professional here. And eventually, Pentagon grabs Vampiro by the collar, and Vampiro pushes Pentagon away, and Vampiro starts, like, unbuttoning his shirt and thinking it's something's about to go down here, and the crowd is dying to see this.
Yeah. Oh shit. The crowd is losing its goddamn mind, dude. They are chanting like hell for Vamp, and Vamp's like kind of getting pumped by it, and Penta's like, yeah, fuck it. Give me this fight. I want to fucking come for it. Fucking frothing at the mouth over here. And of course, Vamp is like, nah, I can't do it. And Penta just kind of dips.
He just leaves, and they're like, well, it's a four-way match now.
Waka waka. Yeah, Vamp's just like, or Penta's like, all right, I'm gonna head out.
fuck this, I'm leaving.
Yeah, and Vamp is, of course, super ashamed TM, and he kind of sits back down dejected at the announcer table. And Striker's we're going to go to commercial. You okay, buddy?
Yeah, and he spends most of the next match kind of, like, sullen and not participating as much as he normally does.
Yeah, Striker's, like, coming back, and he's trying to, like, get Vamp to engage, and Vamp just kind of isn't. And I wrote down a note, which luckily didn't bear out to be true, but I wrote down a note because it looks for a second like Striker about to carry commentary for the rest of the episode. God help us.
Yeah, it's like, is he about to do a solo job and finish the episode out?
I was excited for a complete solo job on Striker's part just to, like, see how many beautiful, iconic malapropisms we get from him. What words will Matt Striker invent today?
It's true. So then it's a four-way match. Aerostar, Marty the Moth, Cage, and the Mac.
Yeah, I made sure to write down a note of they start to say something about, like, if you're unfamiliar with Marty the Moth, and I finish the sentence with, okay, so we start at, or wait, was it, no, this wasn't this episode where Marty was creeping on Melissa, right?
No, it wasn't next time.
Okay. Yeah, no, but it's like, we start off the match, and Striker starts to say something about, if you're unfamiliar with Marty the Martinez, I finish it off with, good, so are we.
Yeah, I feel like this match, more than anything else, was kind of like a show off what Marty can actually do match.
Well, we've had a few of those up to this point, though. He's been in a few, like, four ways and, like, get fed to the shark singles matches. We're just kind of like a recurring theme here. And I love how, like, nobody still has, like, a full grasp on who the fuck Marty is.
I think he just kind of, like, shows up and wrestles and leaves. He doesn't do any of this backstage drama bullshit. No one knows this guy.
Yeah, everyone's like, hey, we got, like, a whole, like, backstage drama thing going on. Why won't he get in on it? They're all very mad.
Yeah. Immediately Cage and the Mac start going at each other.
Oh, yeah.
And that's honestly their focus for the whole rest of the match. is they're mostly interested in fighting each other.
Oh, it's so goddamn cool. It's like, I love, again, this is what I'm talking about. Like, we got, like, one little vignette of, like, Mac and Cage together, where Cage fucking...
Admittedly, it was pretty intense.
Yeah, Cage speared Mac through some lockers, but, like, that's about it. But, like, we're just, like, having the two big boys go at it, and this is what I'm talking about. It's just, like, we saw this little vignette, and it's cool to, like, it feels like, in a way that, like, the big companies just can't replicate, it feels so, like, organic almost, so homegrown, mm-hmm. if that makes any sense.
Yeah, I should have written a bigger note here. I wrote Marty is a freak, and I was probably during one of his earlier sequences where he was kind of just showing off his crazy athleticism and then also like flapping like a moth.
Yeah. Oh, and Vamp has a great line about I thought he was having a seizure with how he was moving his arms there. Yes, of course, as we've remarked before, the highly respectable Aztec family of the moths.
I mean, the moth clan. I mean, in this canon of Aztec history, you have the moth tribe alongside the jaguar tribe, and I think they eventually canonized the death tribe as a thing. There are other tribes that I know of, but that would be spoilers for later in the series.
Historical accuracy.
Yeah. Obviously, back in the old days, back in ancient history, there were 7 Aztec tribes, and they all fought each other in very wrestling-esque ways.
Yes. That is exactly how ancient Aztec culture worked.
Along with their magical medallions.
With their magical medallions. And, you know, the actual IRL dragons that were just flying around everywhere back then.
Yep, good shit.
Whatever.
Yeah, I mean, as for the roles of this match, it kind of fits what you think it's going to fit, honestly. You know, Aerostar is the flyingiest.
Yes.
Marty and the Mac both are kind of... Marty's more flippy than Mac is, but they're both kind of like, can kind of do both. And then you got Cage as the powerhouse.
Yeah, I mean, Cage... I will say, the other cool thing is, like, Cage is, you know, the big, giant monster man, right? But watching him and Mac go at it, it makes Mac feel really cool. Because, like, you know, Mac's a big guy, but he's clearly not as big as Cage. But him being able to go toe-to-toe with Cage makes Mac feel very cool. And it's really fun to see Cage go up against, like, some more varied people. Because, you know, he was on that, like, Puma, that Puma feud forever. So putting him up against, like, people that feel very different from Puma as wrestlers, it's, I don't know, there's something I find really compelling about it.
Mm-hmm. I made note of one time in the house is that Cage at one point grabs Aerostar and then suplex and then Fallaway slams Aerostar over the top rope onto Marty.
Yeah. Oh, like, my God. That was dope. There's another point somewhere where Marty and Mac are both outside the ring and he's like fucking carrying Aerostar. And just so Cage is facing like the center of the ring, and he's like toward the edge, and Marty and Mac are just outside, and he's fireman carrying the Aerostar or whatever. He just casually flips Aerostar behind him onto Marty and Mac without looking, just kind of like went yeet, and it was the most metal shit I've ever seen.
Yeah. I made a note of Marty at one point when he was had the advantage. I think he was pinning Mac, and he pins Mac, and he doesn't get. He gets a 2 count, and he goes to the ref 1-2 trace, 1-2 trace, and then he pins Mac again, and another 2 count, and this time he goes 1-2-3.
What a fucking dork.
Incredible. Aerostar and Marty try to team late in the match. Aerostar and Marty try to team up on Cage, Cage does kind of take him out anyway.
Yeah.
However, this does allow Mac, who had been taken out on the outside early, a little bit earlier, he pulls Cage outside to brawl, and they honestly spend the rest of the match fighting each other on the outside of the ring. Then Marty is up on the top rope. Aerostar, he goes up on the top. He goes up to the top rope from the other side, and then he walks along the middle rope, not the top rope, like Phoenix does. He rocks along the middle rope, and then he Hurricane Rana's Marty, and then Aerostar hits like the no arm splash thing he does.
Yes.
For the win, and has the third Aztec.
Yeah, Aerostar for the dub. Fuck yeah, baby. I'm happy. I know in the front half I said I was like rooting for Marty out of inevitability, but holy shit, my boy Aerostar getting the dub. That's what I'm goddamn talking about. I mean, these medallions, just to reiterate again, are probably hugely fucking cursed. However, it still feels good to watch my boy get a dub.
Sure is a lot of flippy boys winning these medallions. You got Phoenix, though they're quick to say on commentary they do not know the status of Phoenix at this point in time. Because he died. He had the death match and lost. So they're like, when's he coming back?
Don't worry about that.
And Jack Evans and now Aerostar have the medallions.
Yep. And Vamp and Stryker are quick to point out at the beginning of the match that it's been like high flyy boys who have been winning the medallions, and Aerostar continues that tradition. So I wonder if that's gonna like be a thing for all seven, or like if we're gonna get some more giants in there to balance out with the cruisers. I'm fascinated to see kind of like what the prevailing trend is gonna be from here on out.
Sure. So then going forward, we go backstage and Fun and Dysfunctional are training. Angelico is just doing some, I don't know, some stretchy looking shit.
Yep.
And Ivelisse and Son of Havoc are boxing.
Yeah.
And Ivelisse and Son of Havoc start fighting.
Of course they do.
They do. They do be doing that. But then Ivelisse starts like making a remark of like, if you keep this up, so help me God.
Yeah.
And Katrina, it comes in at this exact moment, teleporting in.
God can't help you.
It's like, God can't help you now because death will come for all.
God's not up here. Only Katrina.
And Katrina gets her most flirtatious yet, and I'm including when she was making out with Phoenix on a regular basis.
Oh, yeah. The sexual tension between her and Ivelisse. Mwah.
Yeah, you know, she really thought she was about to plant one on her right, kiss of death on her
right. I thought so, too. I was like, huh, gay?
But nope. She just instead backs up and lifts The Rock.
Fucking lame.
And out, and the Disciples of Death pop up behind Fun and Dysfunctional. And then after some very obvious smash cuts and where you can't really see anything happening,
yes,
they're all knocked out. Fun Dysfunctional's all knocked out. The Disciples beat them up.
I guess Disciples of Death are going for that trio's belt. Woof.
Yep. And then Mil Muertes pops in just to, you know, walk Katrina out of the gym.
Yeah, it was so goddamn goofy. Like, my favorite thing was as fucking the Disciples of Death were rising up behind Fun and Dysfunctional, there was like these electricity
VFX
added in post, and they're like, and it's so fun. It's so clearly added in post, and it's so fucking goofy. But I love how goofy it is.
With the addition of the Disciples of Death, now they're really leaning into this like electricity vibe for whenever any of them walk into the room. Like, it's not just like the lights are flickering thing. Now it's like this idea is if they are like the electricity is going out.
Yeah. Like, I don't know why zombies control electricity. Still not fully sure on that one. But you know, whatever. Also, I guess the Servants of Death or Disciples of Death don't have to like walk in like counterclockwise circles anymore to conjure electricity. They can just kind of do it. I don't know, maybe it's like one of those things, like, you know, they walk in the circle for a little bit and it builds up like a charge they can have over a long period of time. So, like, you know, they got to find a time soon to walk in another counterclockwise circle, but not yet. They still got a little bit of static charge left over, you know?
Yeah. But it does look like for the trios titles that the death is coming for Fun and Dysfunctional.
You know, I think that's pretty fitting. Fun and Dysfunctional is able to stumble through so many dubs, but they can never defeat the inevitabilities of life. Death and tag, which, saying that out loud, all of a sudden, now I need IRS to show up with his own trios tag to be the other possible.
The Disciples of Taxes?
The Disciples of Taxes. Yeah.
It's gotta be alliterative. The Temple of Taxes.
The Temple of Taxes and the Disciples of Death and Team Fun and Dysfunction.
Three-way for the
Yeah. Death and Taxes, baby. Waka waka. They made this joke with Undertaker before, but you know, fuck you. We're making it our own thing. Anyway.
Yes. So we get the main event of episode 33, Drago versus Mil Muertes in a it's not a no DQ match, but you know, it's effectively one. In a match for the number one contendership for Ultima Lucha.
Yeah, no. That's an oof to start off, because we know how that one's gonna go. And also, Hernandez just kind of like shows up after Drago makes his entrance, just fuck him up a little bit.
Yeah, he is apparently big mad about losing last 2 weeks ago, and his response is to just beat the shit out of Drago.
Yeah, he debelts himself and like fucking tries to choke Drago out with his belt,
which is about to be, as it turns out, a motif
to an extent. We'll get there. That's a surprise tool for later.
Yes. So after the whipping of a dragon, Hernandez bounces out, and so we cut back from commercial break, and like the referee is like asking Drago if he's still good to fight. Mm-hmm. Drago, of course, answers yes.
Yeah, and Bam's like, you can't keep Drago down. That's only gonna make him more angry. You've tapped into the fury of Drago.
I wrote down the exact quote because please. I was like, this is absolutely insane from Vampiro.
Vampiro says is absolutely insane.
Yeah, that beating has only provoked devastation inside that man's soul.
Sure. Oh wait. Also. Wait, is this now or is it? Oh no, that was next episode. Never mind. Keep going.
Mm-hmm. So then out comes Mil Muertes and Katrina,
and it is the match of the white iris contacts. We stare into both of their dead eyes. These men, both having come so far from where they started, and you can tell they've made character progress because they're both wearing contacts that make their irises pure white. Ah.
Drago is now colored a dark purple.
Yeah. Is it dark purple? It just reads as black to me.
I thought it was more dark purple than black. Whatever. But it's pretty dark either way.
Yes, he's no longer a friendly, happy blue dragon. Now he's an angry dark purple / black dragon.
Unfortunately, did not help.
Yeah, you know, unfortunately.
It was a largely one-sided affair because Drago is supposed to be injured, and you know, Mil Muertes is the hot new thing.
Yeah. Also, Vampiro at one point insinuates that he said something about like, you know, professionalism, but this is a match that won't be professional. Insinuating that zombies and hell dragons are incapable of professionalism, which I will have you know, many of my friends are both zombies and hell dragons. They are some of the most professional people I've ever met.
Absolutely. So
check your privilege, Vampiro.
That's very offensive.
Deeply. I'm shocked and appalled. Shout out to this match kind of finally really making me realize just how much like Mil Muertes is like a tribute act to Undertaker. Cause like he's got the valet with the magic item. He's an undead zombie wizard. And he's now doing the fucking sit-up spots.
We need Mil Muertes to do a PSA about how there's no hope with dope.
Wait, no way. Yes. No way.
The Undertaker did. The Undertaker in the 90s did an anti-drug PSA where he's literally like, he like literally is shoveling open a grave spot for, and then as, and then he's like, there's no hope with dope.
Please, please tell me that he ends it by saying, if you do drugs, you're going to rest in pieces.
No, that was the end line, was no hope with dope.
Lame. Wait, you had such a fucking gimme right there. Like, what? Okay, you can have him start to say, there's no hope with dope. Which, first of all, Undertaker being a narc is just so disappointing.
I mean, it kind of checks out. It's like implied he was born in like the Civil War era of America.
Oh, shit. Oh no. Oh no, Undertaker's an ultimate boomer. Oh shit.
Yeah, because like in a different storyline where he is forced to be on Team America, he opens his coat and it's like an older version of the American flag.
Oh my god. Is this when he was a biker, or?
No, this was Survivor Series 1993.
Okay. Weird.
And that was New Generation nonsense.
I have to say, in that instance, I appreciate the attention to detail.
Yeah.
But anyway, so regardless of whether or not there's hope with dope, I did finally realize, I'm now like paranoid that I actually have made this connection in previous episodes and I'm just forgetting, but I feel like this is the first time I really connected with like, holy shit, this guy just kind of is like Mexican variant, like masked luchador Undertaker.
Yeah, a little bit.
Anyway, so one-sided affair.
Paul Bearer would be an even better manager if he started licking people.
I want Paul Bearer to choke Vince McMahon and to make out with people, have a steamy affair with one of the Undertaker's, you know, rivals at one point.
Steamy affair with Checks Notes. Mankind?
I would pay good money to see Paul Bearer aggressively make out with Mankind. Holy shit.
Oh, no!
That is the kind of rep that the LGBT community needs on WWE TV, okay? I will accept nothing less. Fuck the Billy and Chuck angle. The marriage should have been between Mick Foley and Paul Bearer.
Oh, boy.
Paul Bearer, do you take Mankind to be your lawfully wedded husband? Oh, yes!
I really didn't think that we could possibly go here on this particular episode. I thought...
We always find a way to go here. We were making incest jokes out of Heidenreich.
But that felt connected to what we were to the episode.
It kind of got rabbit holey, okay?
What a deep rabbit hole we've gone
always
down
here. We always get this whole show is a rabbit hole. Anyway.
Back to the match.
Finally. Yeah. So one-sided affair. Shit's getting messy because of course it is. Mil Muertes grabs the wooden chairs from the audience and starts yeeting Drago around in them, on them, etc.
The crowd chants, "Get the coffin!"
Yikes! And then chair shenanigans happen, and then the crowd proceeds to chant, "We want tables," because again, bloodthirsty motherfuckers, a lot of them.
This is how dragons die, with thunderous applause.
Yeah, and Mil Muertes is more than happy to oblige with the commentator's table.
Yeah, slams Drago into the announcer's desk.
Kind of surprised it didn't break.
Yeah, but Drago, he fights hard. He fights best he can, but you know.
And like, you gotta wonder, in this no DQ match, where the fuck are Drago's nunchucks? He's training with them. It's clearly no DQ. My man, why didn't you come packing heat?
He probably could have brought his nunchucks and it would have been fine.
Yeah, like, look, I know Mil Muertes is the scary zombie man who controls electricity or whatever, but I even don't think scary zombie man who controls electricity or whatever can properly stand up terribly well to, you know, getting beamed in the head with fucking nunchucks.
Junk.
Yeah, exactly. Police. Yeah, we find out. I is God, I keep getting this match and the one from the next episode mixed up. Is this where they say that he's a that nope. Drago's a kung fu master? Is that next episode?
Nah, it's next.
All right, we'll get there then.
But we'll get a payoff to the nunchucks eventually.
Yeah, sure. But you know, all this to say, shockingly, rip in pieces, Drago.
Yeah, Mil Muertes rat gets Drago up for the flatliner for the win, and then Katrina crawls on in there, licks Drago, then starts macking on Mil.
You know, wholesome. Their version of a menage a trois.
Their relationship is very healthy, you know.
Very healthy, very stable, and they are two completely well-adjusted humans whose mental faculties we should not be worried about in the slightest.
Yeah. You know, and then Puma comes down to confront Mil, and Conan is in all white, and I'm like, symbolism.
Absolutely. Absolutely, we got to have our visual distinctions.
Yep. So then that is the end of episode 33. We move on to then episode 34. In Dario's office, Chavo walks in and he demands that Dario give him the last thing he asked for. And Dario jokingly forgets what he asked for.
Yeah, yeah. It's a joke. I'm joking.
Yeah, and what Chavo wanted was a shot at the Lucha Underground Championship. And sure. Dario explains that Chavo can get anything he wants for all the good work he's done. And Chavo is like, well, anything?
Anything?
And he says that, you know, the match would be a lot better, you know, if Conan and his cane weren't around.
Yeah, fuck this Conan guy. Fuck his cane.
And Dario says, well, how about this? If Conan interferes, you win the title.
Which, sidebar, gotta say, I just kind of have expected Dario to put out a hit on Conan instead and found it almost anticlimactic that he's like, oh yeah, no, we can just keep Conan intact and just ban him from ringside. Okay.
Yeah, sure. But then, well, I mean, is the crew really that effective for hits?
No, but like, I don't know. Maybe it's finally time to let Matanza out of the cage or something. Or I don't know. I'm sure you have someone on your payroll who'd be willing to like kick that old man's ass if you floated them a little bit of extra cash. Something
Rick,
here.
Rick could do it, but he's too busy getting paid by Daivari. He's too. He cannot outprice Daivari.
Do you think?
So.
Do you think? That, like, for a little bit of extra elbow grease or whatever, palm grease, that Rick would be like, yeah, sure, why not? something else, though. Man, Dario's, like, really playing all sides and so he can come out on top. Because he's just, like, he's just willing to promise everybody everything, even though, like, you know, he's shown to be a shady motherfucker, and like Chavo knows if he wins against Puma, he has to go up against like supreme scary motherfucker Mil. And I know Chavo's like cocky, but like, man, you think he'd have some trepidation about that? You think anybody would have any trepidation about agreeing to something with Dario, seeing how like everything that Dario like kind of promises people always ends up like fucking monkey paw backfiring on them? You feel like his subordinates would catch on by this point or something.
No,
that,
they're all,
that
they're
it's
all,
literally the only
all
winner
like,
at the end of the day is always like, fucking Dario.
They're all like, no, it can't possibly happen to me.
Yes. Oh, no, the tiger is eating my face. How did this happen?
I never thought the leopard would eat my face.
The leopard, pardon me.
The leopard eating faces group.
Dario Cueto, famous leopard, notable for face eating.
Yes. So then the first match of the second episode here is Delavar Daivari versus Tejano.
Yeah. This was just kind of like an okay, sure match.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like I've only ever watched Daivari wrestle Tejano at this point.
Yeah, seriously. And we just kind of hate Daivari because he's rich, which like technically based, but also like that means we're rooting for Tejano by default, which doesn't feel right. Tejano just seems like an annoying asshole.
Yeah, I mean, it's fine. I don't, I don't really care about this storyline enough to be excited for Matt's three.
Yeah, me neither. It was a solid match. That was about it. I don't really give a shit. I do want to say, backing it up a little bit to when the episode started. We have a new band performing for the temple, Mexican Dubweiser, which that's a great name. Singer for Mexican Dubweiser is like this elderly black gentleman with like who's wearing like short sleeve button up bow tie, like kind of looking like a dork, and he is my new favorite. The vibes he gives
I am not surprised that Bow Tie Dude is your new favorite of the singers of this
he gives off proud dork vibes, and it me.
Yep. So I made a note that Vampiro seemed to be struggling with remembering and saying Delavar Divari's name. He stumbled around with it a lot.
Do you mean Delavari?
Yeah, at one point he does end up mixing both names and calling him Delavari.
And Stryker calls him out for it, and Vamp's like, well, yeah, you know, I just felt like it was appropriate. Yeah, okay, buddy, sure.
Yeah, all right. The match goes about out. The match goes how you think it's gonna go, in that Tejano is way higher level than Divari. So Big Rick just shows up to interfere every once in a while, and that's how Divari gets the advantage.
Real shocker there. We gotta have our scary boy muscle to make the heel more of a bastard or whatever.
I feel like Vampiro was on something this match, because I made note of him giving shit to the referee, talking about how you can't trust a guy who's called Lefty but is right-handed, which I'm pretty sure Matt Stryker gave Lefty that name anyway.
Yeah, oh my god, I forgot about the fucking Lefty thing. That was so goofy.
Yeah, and then Vampiro tries to, like, says some shit about the Globetrotters and like, why don't they win the NBA championship or whatever? And then he like gives Rick shit for wearing an eye patch. Being like, you got to turn all the way to see anything.
What? I don't understand Vampiro.
And then during a moment where like they're doing the bit where both wrestlers are down, and so the ref is like, one, two, three. And if they had stayed down for the town of Kent, both stayed down for Tenet's draw. So they're doing that bit, and Vampiro just is like, hey, do you think Rick can count? To which Stryker has to be like, yes, Rick can count.
What does that mean, Vampiro?
Like, Why do you think Rick is stupid?
Is it because he's black, Vampiro?
I would be more inclined to think it's just because he's the muscle.
Maybe, but also
racial thing. But
Vampiro goes on to say like some kind of ableist shit. So I don't know. I feel like he might have some preconceived biases that he has yet to examine.
Sure. So the end of the match here is that Rick grabs the bull rope that Tejano always brings to the match. He wraps it around his fist. He tries to hit Tejano, manages to miss. Tejano super kicks Rick off the apron, and then Tejano just walks over and hits sit-out powerbomb for the win. Go to hell and die to Divari.
Yeah, sure, waka waka. I don't give a shit, but congrats to our new face turned Tejano.
Well, that's the end of that, hopefully. As we go backstage where Conan is like ruminating and pondering while Puma is working out, and he's like, Chavo is many things. He's a snake and a dirtbag, but he's not a champion. Yeah. So he's like, just stay focused and don't worry about it. You got this tonight.
The standard Conan pep talk. Sure.
And then Katrina arrives to talk shit.
Yeah. Dude, Katrina's fucking popping this in on everybody.
This was a very heavy two episodes of Katrina and Mil Muertes. And I don't hate it, but also she kind of just says the same shit three times.
Motherfuckers getting cocky. They're just like, nobody can defeat Mil Muertes. Wow.
Hey, you suck, and you suck, and you suck.
I'm better than you. Mil Muertes be like, cut my music. And then he shoots a fucking lightning bolt at the speakers to turn them off.
Yeah. So Katrina, you know, she says all of her normal shit. And then Mil Muertes, they do a cool, really cool shot.
Yeah, okay, I gotta shut this up. This dope-ass, like, perspective shot of, like, from underneath of Mil walking through the locker room toward Puma, that makes him look like a goddamn giant. That was horrifying. The camera guy keeps continuing to, like, waffle back and forth between artistic genius and absolute
the greatest thing ever, the worst thing ever.
This is, he's on the greatest side for now. We'll see how long that lasts.
Yeah, so you get a cool stare down between Prince Puma and Mil Muertes before the dark, the death guys teleport out of there. And then Conan is like, it's all mind games. Don't let him get in your head.
Yeah. Conan ability to uncanny ability to just stay cool in any situation. Like, he don't give me excuses. Give me results. The fucking like, temple is like burning down around them, and he's like, it's just all mind games. Fucking go get the
mind games, or I'm disowning you. Focus,
or I'm disowning you.
Yeah. So we go to another commercial break, and then we go back to the locker room, and Conan is talking to a mystery figure, and he's talking about how, you know, I know you want Chavo's ass, and he's like, you know what? After this, you know, it's no DQ. After all this shit. You know, it's time to get back at Chavo for Mexico.
Yeah, fucking Conan really said, they said I couldn't be at ringside. They didn't say shit about nobody else.
You, yeah.
Hey-o. I realized I gotta take it back to the last match, because something I completely forgot to call out was at one point Stryker actually gained self-awareness and questioned why officials keep missing heel shenanigans, like, after all these years of that continuing to be a thing.
I think that's why Vampiro started ranting about the Globetrotters.
It might have been. But yeah, I just remembered Stryker says the thing we've always been thinking of, like, man, after years and years of, like, proof that heels like to heel it up and, like, do shit while the ref's back is turned, why the fuck haven't the refs wised up to, like, hey, there's probably bullshit going on behind my back right now. I should, you know, check that out.
I'm going to need you to stop saying the quiet part out loud. That it's all fake. That's why.
Strikers over here fucking breaking kayfabe in real time. Whoops.
Yeah, fuck off of that shit.
How about you not?
So the second match of episode 34, Hernandez versus Drago. We're just getting right to it.
Hell yeah.
After last week. I know Hernandez looked kind of spooked by Drago's whole thing coming out.
Yeah, his cool has been broken a little bit. He's like, what have I gotten myself involved with?
Yeah. And it is this match where they explain that Drago is a champion of karate.
Yeah, yeah. So another thing to add to the lore list is that apparently dragons can and have become karate champions, which would explain the nunchucks.
Yeah, it would explain the nunchucks. Is that why last time I hypothesized that Drago's inability to fly and not look like a dork flying was actually the reason he was able to survive when all the other dragons went extinct. But perhaps it was not his inability to fly that allowed him to survive when all other dragons failed. It was his proclivities towards karate.
Absolutely. Fucking all the other dragons were making fun of Drago for getting his black belt, and Drago's like, fuck you guys, I'll show you one day, I'll show you all, it's worth it. And then, like, the dragon slayers come to town, and all the dragons are like, oh shit, we're all dying.
The great dragon genocide that happened at some point.
Drago standing proud in the middle of it all, with his black belt proudly displayed, goes, Kia! And then proceeds to fight his way past all the assailants and survive the great dragon massacre. I think we found the true answer here, Austin. This is what makes perfect sense.
To paraphrase Kimba the White Lion, now that you're thinking about this.
Kimba the White Lion!
If only those dragons had been more like Drago, then they wouldn't have had to have been exterminated.
Ah! Oh yeah, I forgot about the practical genocide apology that happens in the Kimba the White Line genocide episode. You know, elephants. It sure is a tragedy you got genocided, but have you considered getting
that
good?
You're all asshole. Have you considered that you're all assholes and you deserved it?
Yeah, you know, a thing that cultures famously deserve, genocide.
Yes. Same thing happened with the dragons here, is they were all assholes and they got genocided by tanks or something.
Then all the dragons loved him before they proceeded to die. Drago, the black belt dragon. He went to a cave and cried. Anyway. You know, everybody's favorite Christmas carol, Drago the Black Belt Dragon.
What is our show? What are the things that we say?
Guys, I think I broke Austin. I think he's a little bit. Austin has gone bye-bye, friends. Well then. Looks like I'm taking over this here podcast, folks. Austin is indisposed because he finds a great amount of comedic value in Drago the Black Belt Dragon.
Okay. Let's...
Y'all get there, buddy? Are you sure?
Let's get back to the wrestling.
God. Anyway,
why does this keep happening with the Dragon Man?
We gotta keep adding lore, Austin. What is Lucha Underground without its random fucking lore?
It's
right up there in you know, brilliant creative choices with, you know, the Moth Tribe of ancient Azteca.
The ancient Moth Tribe. I respect the Moth Tribe.
I don't. That's your cross to bear, my man.
You'll see.
I will see. You'll all see.
Yeah, so the match is honestly very similar structure to the Drago Mil Muertes fight from the about 15 minutes prior.
Yes. However,
Hernandez ain't no Mil Muertes, so Drago gets a lot more offense.
Yes, and the match ends in a rather interesting way, wherein Hernandez fucking seizes somebody from the crowd, rips off the audience member's belt. I assume this person was a plant, but still, what the fuck? You know, seizes somebody from the crowd, rips off his belt, and then proceeds to choke Drago out with it, which gets him fucking disqualified.
I know where this is leading. From that, we are not done with this story.
Please tell me random audience member gets involved in this whole segment, in this whole like thing.
Do not wish to spoil how this goes from here.
Okay.
But Hernandez, we get Vampiro making the lovely comment of "that's some prison love right there."
Prison rape jokes. Thank you.
Yeah, that's about right. And then Hernandez, like the biggest heel in the whole building, in my book, he gets a microphone after this match.
Yes,
and he says, "You dumbass fans, you don't realize dragons aren't real."
Hey, fuck this guy! Fuck this guy! What the fuck? Dragons are very real. I know. I have believed in dragons all my life. How can you say that? Next, you'll say that Reaganomics don't actually trickle down to the low to the working class. Fucking get out of here with your this ain't real, that ain't real.
Well, hey,
bullshit.
Now,
I believe in facts.
Well, one of those is a fairy tale.
One of those is a fairy tale, and it ain't dragons. Let me tell you.
And the other thing is about dragons.
Hey ho!
So
get fucking wrecked. Anyway.
So yeah, he explains that Drago is just a man that he whooped ass, and the crowd is jeering him, and he starts challenging fans to fight him.
Yeah.
Fight me, bro.
Like, come at me, bro. And honestly, there are a few people in the crowd who looks like they are more than willing to, like, take that off.
They would have been willing to try.
Absolutely. I feel like Hernandez, if Hernandez had, like, stepped a little too close to, like, one of the, like, within one of those fans, like, you know, personal bubble, they would have just fucking jumped him, which I think would have been a great addition to this episode is Hernandez getting in actual IRL shoot fights with the fans because he told them dragons aren't real. Yeah, another thing to add to the list of something that actually gets under this deeply fucked up audience's skin is being told that dragons aren't real. Man, their priorities are just on so straight.
Fuck that.
Anyway.
So backstage, Chavo Guerrero is getting ready for his big match tonight, and guess who? Katrina.
Waka waka.
What if Katrina said the same thing for a third time in this series of episodes?
Why, it's so much, I think I'll have it a third time.
So then Mill teleports in, and Chavo is like, yeah, fuck this, I ain't scared of nothing.
Yeah, Chavo just, you know, giving off pure Chavo vibes of, like, everyone else is, like, kind of intimidated by the zombie guy. Chavo's like, nah, it's cool.
I can take him.
I can't. I'm a guerrero.
And then Mill just rage screams.
Yeah, Mill Muertes deeply insulted that Chavo's not quaking in his boots at the sight of him.
Yep. So Mill's then match like, number... Oh, sorry.
Mill's just like, there's a decorum to this.
So then anyway. Match three, Marty the Moth Martinez versus Alberto El Patron. And Marty is uncomfortably close to Melissa Santos.
Just, you know, Joe Bidening Melissa Santos, as you do.
Get used to that. He'll be doing that a lot.
I feel like we've seen him do that previously, too.
Yeah. I do love Marty the Moth's bright yellow Aztec Pride shirt that is just bright yellow and in black letters, Aztec Pride. I feel like
he's got the colors of the wrong insect on there, but you know, you do you, boo.
Yeah, it looks a little bee-ish.
Yeah, a little bit. Hey, you know what? For all we know, there is a fucking, like, Aztec bee tribe, all right? They like, put out their hands and go... Bzz, bzz, bzz.
A bee tribe and a moth tribe? That seems excessive.
Better rivals. They were like, there can only be one insect-themed ancient Aztec tribe. And they fought for supremacy for many years. This is true, actually.
Mm-hmm. That's fair.
That checks out.
So, Alberto El Patron, it's a squash match again. Another one.
Yeah, you look.
Squash which, Marty.
Man, I'm kind of stuck between a rock and a hard place here because I'm still fucking weirded out by this Marty guy. But also, fuck Alberto El Patron, so everybody's a loser today. Vamp, the great little scene between Stryker and Matt. Stryker and Vamp.
Kayfabe bad to women versus shoot bad to women. What a terrible place to be in.
Oh, man, this is just woof. No, but at one point, like, Vampiro starts to say, is it just me? Or, and then Stryker cuts him off and goes, it's usually you.
Meh. But we are...
Way to call him out. Beautiful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we are continuing the plot thread of questioning, like, is Marty legit about this tribe thing?
Probably.
I admit I've already kind of given the game away by talking about his moth tribe, but this was the season one story here of like, is he legit when he's talking about having Aztec DNA?
God, we're about to do some like mint berry crunch shit with this, aren't we? Where he's like the gooberiest of all the like tribe reps or whatever. But then like, you know, there's going to be some like moth deity that shows up at some point and is like, my son, you have become worthy, inherit my godly moth power, and then Marty's just start like fucking flying around and like dicking on everybody.
I will in fact not say anything with regards to where this art goes with Marty.
I get the feeling it's gonna be like variations on a theme of Mintberry Crunch. That is my prediction that I'm putting in right now.
Mm-hmm. So after the match, Alberto El Patron gets a mic and he calls out Johnny Mundo. And he talks about how Johnny Mundo made a big old mistake by putting him through the window because it stirred up something crazy in him, something sadistic. And it's like, I feel like I am being like, I am actively being gaslit on how this storyline went.
Yeah.
I know that I understand that significant, that like the announcers in the crowd have absolutely no context for all that shit that happened backstage when Alberto El Patron was passive aggressively being a dick. But also, but absolutely nobody is talking about it. And it feels like I'm, and it's like, what the fuck? I remember this.
Yeah, like, I don't understand why the hell they played it that way. Because, like, Alberto Patron is, like, this fucking cultural icon hero. And then they, like, backstage had him act like a dick to Johnny Mundo. But then, like, as far as anyone who, like, doesn't watch the TV show knows, he's just a great guy. And Johnny Mundo's this asshole heel who's just dicking on everybody's favorite cultural icon for no reason. Mm-hmm. And there doesn't seem to be any like payoff coming about that. So why even do it like that in the first place?
Yeah. I mean, cool. This storyline doesn't have very much longer to go anyway. It's whatever.
I will say I appreciate at the very least the fact that the TV show was willing to kind of like turn and wink at me and go like, you know, all these idiots out here think that Patron's a good guy, but we both know who the true asshole is here.
Mm-hmm.
Which, like, you know, I appreciate that.
It's
fuck
a cool
Alberto El Patron.
It's a really neat concept for to tell a story in a way that only Lucha Underground could do because of the way they set up the show.
But
I also
really
feel like
shit.
They're not. I feel like they're not really like actively calling it out.
Yeah. Okay.
Yep.
Moving on. Hey. But yeah. So yeah.
He ends with
Alberto
his,
Patron just says, "Wake me up inside.
Wake me up.
Yeah.
Save me.
Specifically from Johnny Mundo.
Yep. And then we move on to the main event of the evening, Chavo Guerrero versus Prince Puma in a no DQ match, except if Conan gets involved.
Which Vampiro is, of course, extremely horny for.
Yeah. And then for the Lucha Underground Championship, I wrote Vampiro doesn't know where Bale is. Oof. Vampiro is the one who calls it out. It's like, you know, we haven't seen Bale for weeks. Wonder what's happened to that guy. And it's like,
yeah. Yeah. So talk about like nobody, like talk about the shit that happens backstage that nobody like IRL has any context for. They're still like, where the fuck is Bale? I don't know. Okay. Don't investigate any further.
Please think no further about it.
I hope he's having a nice vacation.
Yeah. So honestly, the match is just a step above a squash match.
Yeah.
Which honestly, I feel like checks out for the most part because Chavo Guerrero is a dirtbag.
Yeah.
But he's not been portrayed as a particularly powerful dirtbag.
Yeah. It's honestly kind of satisfying to watch Chavo get his shit knocked around. And the only way that he's like standing on any legs at all to like properly face up against like the extremely battle hardened Prince Puma is by having like the 2/3 of crew fuck around and find out during the match.
Yeah. Yeah, so Chavo, I wrote he fakes a leg injury, but he also limps on it the whole rest of the mat, so maybe it was a real one. I just assumed it was fake, because that sounds about right.
Yeah, honestly, we'll find out.
We've
had instances on the show before where we're like not entirely sure if we're getting worked when it comes to injuries, because like either way, people will be like pretty hardcore about selling them. But also, shout out to commentary having, for the second episode in a row, ex-babyface has to overcome the odds. How many times can they do this? Commentary, which boo, get some new fucking material. We get it. The baby faces keep going up against impossible odds and keep coming out on top. When's the other shoe gonna drop? We get it. The other shoe's dropping soon. Just please.
Yeah,
please.
I have a good guess when that shoe's about to drop.
You know, how many
episodes are left in the season? 5?
I have a pretty solid about guess, then. And by that I mean I kind of know exactly what's gonna happen because I like accidentally spoiled myself on what the fuck goes on with Matanza. At the end of the season.
Oops,
so
sorry.
That's not something for you to apologize. That was me getting curious about like Jeff Cobb as a wrestler and then like accidentally like
yes,
on his
he
Wikipedia
is
page.
Yeah, he's Matanza.
Yeah. Well, I figured that out And you know, he's been showing up on AEW and stuff. So I'm like, you know, I want to learn more about this Jeff Cobb guy. It seems like he gets around a lot. What has he done? And then I like accidentally like skimmed over like part of his Wikipedia page that talks about what happens at the end of season one of Lucha Underground. And I was like, God fucking damn it.
Yep. So Chavo, even though it is a no DQ match and they could have jumped in at any time, it's not until Chavo gets hurt and the ref's back is turned that the crew jump in.
I know, I know. Again, technically no DQ, but whatever.
Yeah, so the crew go to town. I mean, Prince Paul,
the crew are just so used to doing shady bullshit that they're just like, they just like default to doing it in shady mode, even if it's completely legal.
Yeah, they're not used to just being able to just do it. They gotta make an opportunity. So Prince Puma almost fights the two of them off by himself, but he does end up getting double teamed and taken down. There, Chavo is going up to the top rope, and at this point, Conan yells to his cavalry, and it's Tejano to come and even the odds. And he takes out everybody. Yeah, he is now the face of Mexico or whatever.
Sure.
He takes everybody out. Puma hits the 630 and wins. Fuck you.
Yeah, Chavo goes down like a fucking bitch.
Yeah, the match only goes like 7 minutes at most.
Honestly, it's really
short for a main event.
Dude, we've seen so many like challenges for Puma's title wherein they're just like these deeply stressful wars. It's honestly really nice to see Puma do a match where he just like easily kicks ass, and the only reason he has any trouble whatsoever is because of like heel shenanigans.
Mm-hmm, that's fair. I agree. So then after the match, Tejano gets on the microphone and explains to Chavo that Mexico is still coming for him. As it turns out, beating Blue Demon Jr. a second time did not scare the whole of Mexico away. So
shock of all
shock. Sorry about that. Yeah, and then we get a rare post-credit scene.
Yeah.
And Chavo is sitting in the locker room. He's pissed off. And then Blue Demon walks in. And Chavo, like, tries to bait him into something. And Blue Demon is like, nah, man, I'm not going to fight you.
I have honor. Fuck you.
You're already hurt. I'm not going to fight an injured man. I'm a good man. I'm not you. And Chavo decides to still needle him, though. And he talks about how, like, man, sure, I bet you wish that was you out there tonight who kicked my ass and had the adoring cheers of the fans.
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe it's because the fans realize that you washed up and you suck and Tejano's better than you. And okay. Tejano is Mexico. And this pisses off Blue Demon. He, like, starts pushing Chavo into the lockers. And he goes that I am Mexico, and he walks off, and Chavo smirking like a little shit because he is now caught. He is now pushing the two people trying to kick his ass into kicking each other's ass instead.
I will say though,
he comes out safest again.
Yeah, as much as I will say though, much as it's annoying to see Chavo continue to pull more heel bullshit, that I am Mexico Chavo line from Blue Demon was so metal. Like we've only gotten kind of like just, you know, nostalgia act Blue Demon in Lucha Underground up until this point. He's kind of here to be like, ah, look everybody, it's Blue Demon. Ah,
yay!
So hearing him go, I am Mexico, was kind of awesome. That he went up about like 20 cool points in my book just for that. So. Fuck yeah. Love me some Blue Demon. I am now a big Blue Demon guy. Let's go.
Yeah, so that ends the episode. And the two more good episodes. It's all building. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 episodes left in season one. We are coming down the stretch.
That's so wild, dude.
Yep. So only 3 more episodes of our podcast before we're done with season one.
Season one. We got 3 more seasons to go, baby.
Oh, man. All right.
Hey, look. This is like our long-running thing. We're doing this for years and years.
Yep. So that is the end of episode today. Next time on the Noobs and Knockouts podcast, another storyline we're finally getting back to.
We're going
back to July 2005. Is SmackDown And last time we learned that Eddie, he knows a secret. And what will Rey Mysterio do to not have that secret spilled?
We will find out.
I guess we got to find out.
In the greatest storyline that WWE ever told. Oh, God, I'm so fucking happy we're doing this. Holy shit. Yeah. I am so excited.
Yeah. So, but that is for next time. Until then, David, hit our plugs.
Yes, sir. My friends, my dear friends, thank you so much for joining us on for yet another episode of the Noobs and Knockouts podcast. We are so, so delighted to have you here. Returning listeners, viewers, what have you, you know the drill. Thank you so much for once again welcoming us back into your eardrums, your eyeballs, whatever it is you use to consume our content. Just keep coming back. You know you love it. We love having you here. New people, hey, how's it going? We here at the Noobs and Knockouts podcast like to think we are friendly to both noobs and knockouts alike. So whether you are brand new to the wrestling fandom or you're a grizzled veteran of the discourse, either way, we hope you've had a great time here. We hope you feel welcome here and you know, like you want to keep coming back. If you would like to keep coming back, feeling welcome, having a great time with us here, and you're not entirely sure how to do so, not to worry, my friends, I have you covered. First of all, you can find us on YouTube. We are the Noobs and Knockouts podcast on YouTube. Hit subscribe, ring that bell, and make sure it turns a nice little solid color so you get notifications every single time we drop a brand new episode. Just, you know, give us all that sweet, sweet engagement. Come check out all of our playlists. Austin has been kind enough to organize all the storylines that we follow into their own, like, kind of separate little playlist. So if you want to follow a certain thing all the way down, you can do that without a whole lot of skipping around. And on more recent episodes, you can see our beautiful faces, our lovely, sexy, like, updated HUD, all the little visual gags that we hide in there for the people who bother to watch us. It's a great time. Come check us out, Noobs and Knockouts podcast on YouTube. But of course, for those of you who enjoy the audio only experience, we have options for you too. Noobs and Knockouts, you can find out three of the best places to find your podcast, which would be Spotify, Google, and Apple Podcasts. Come check us out there. Give us a 5-star rating. Give us a positive review. Download our fucking episodes. Check all of it out. Tell the algorithm with your nice words, if you're so inclined, that these guys are pretty cool and, you know, maybe more people should be listening to them. I don't know. Just saying. Noobs and Knockouts podcast on Spotify, on Google, and Apple Podcasts. That audio experience, it's a good time. Then, of course, to get in kind of contact with us, there is all of our little social media stuff. First and foremost is our Twitter. You can find us on Twitter at Noobs and Knoxpod on Twitter. That's Noobs, the letter N, Knoxpod on Twitter. Come check us out there. You know, we do memes. We do discourse. We drop, we post every single time we drop a brand new episode so you guys know what the hell is going on. Of course, the highlight of our Twitter is weekly wrestling live tweeting. My friend, what is on the docket coming up?
Right, as per usual, every Wednesday night at 8 p.m. Eastern on TBS is AEW Dynamite.
I know, Mike.
Me and David watch that pretty much every week live, so one of us, at least one of us is tweeting about that. Then also, I keep up with WWE, AEW, and Impact Wrestling pay-per-views. So upcoming for WWE on July 30th, I am busy that night, so I won't be watching live. But that is WWE SummerSlam.
Which will not be headlined by Brock Lesnar versus Roman Reigns anymore.
Well, that hasn't been changed yet.
Well.
And the storyline is that this is the last time they are ever going to fucking wrestle, which... Well, that's looking to be about right anyway. If it happens, yeah.
Okay.
So you got that. You know, Liv Morgan versus Ronda Rousey. Please, I need in my life somebody from the Riot Squad beating Ronda Rousey.
Yes, you know, please.
Ruby Soho ain't going to do shit for me. So you know what? Liv Morgan is champion. Best I'm going to get. I'll take it.
Hell please. Yes. Please.
Logan Paul versus The Miz.
All yep. Right. Yep. Logan Paul's now officially signed with the WWE.
Yeah.
Baby.
All right.
Fucking go.
And Matt Riddle versus Seth Rollins. Probably going to be the best technical match of the night.
Indeed.
Bianca Belair versus Becky Lynch. You know, it would be funny if Bianca won this match in like 30 seconds, but I would prefer if she didn't.
Oh, well.
Well, because, you know, because Becky beat her last year.
In 30 seconds. Well, you know, give us a real match, please. But, you know, Booker's going to book her.
Sure. Well, whoever the booker is nowadays.
Well, yeah, we'll find out.
Bruce Pritchard is doing the booking right now.
Oh, good. Well, we'll find out.
Yep. So that's WWE. It's July 30th for Saturday for SummerSlam, but I have stuff to do, so I won't be watching that one. Meanwhile, the AEW All Out is September the 4th. So obviously we don't really have any matches going for that one right now, but you know, it's back in Chicago again. Probably going to be pretty sick. They don't do a lot of pay-per-views anyway. And then Impact Wrestling has Bound for Glory upcoming in October. They do not currently have any matches set for that, obviously, but we'll keep you up to date on that as it happens.
Absolutely. Be sure to check all of that out. It's a great time over on the Twitter. If you enjoy listening to this podcast, you know, Austin's voice and my voice, they both carry over pretty fucking solidly to the Twitter. So if you enjoy listening to one or both of us ramble about wrestling for, you know, hours on end here, you'll enjoy it over on the Twitter. Noobs and Knox Pod on Twitter. Come check us out there. For super direct contact with us, of course, there is our email address. You can email us at noobsandknockoutspod@gmail.com. That's noobs, the word and this time, knockoutspod@gmail.com. Pardon me. Holy shit. Anyway, be sure to come say hi to us there. Tell us what you like about the show, what you don't like, things you want to see more of, less of, requests for any kind of wrestling media you might want us to check out for the podcast. We are more than amenable to ideas around here. Oh boy, do we love them. You know, to yell at us for our hot takes or tell them that they're super, tell us that they're super based or whatever. Just, you know, whatever it is, come say hi to us. We love people saying hi. We would love to say hi back. Noobsandknockoutspod@gmail.com. And of course, finally, there is our Patreon. We are also the Noobs and Knockouts podcast on Patreon. $1 a month gives you early access to episodes and a shout out at the end of each episode. Shout out to our $1 tier friend of the show, the sugar daddy, Kyle Smith, for his support. Enjoy your perks, buddy. If you want to enjoy perks along with Kyle, be sure to join us. Noobs and Knockouts pod at Gmail, or getting my plugs mixed up. Noobs and Knockouts on Patreon. Oh boy.
Yeah. So see y'all next time.
Hasta luego.